promise y'all too. Church with you from Sabbath to Sabbath. What do you focus on? How they dress? How they interact with one another? What do you focus on? Do you see some nice Christian friends and relatives dressed up in their Sabbath best, who seem to have it all together, as we say? Or do you visualize people who are hurting, needing to be comforted? People who are troubled about many things, seeking peace of mind. People who are sick in many ways, needing healing. What do you see? You see, people come to church all dressed up in their best clothes and wearing their best smiles. Most of them look okay, so we assume that everything is right. And when we ask them, my brother or my sister, how are you doing? And they say, I'm good. And you assume that everything is okay. You accept that response. Okay. However, many times we need to look beyond the dressing up look and the automatic response. For deep down in their hearts, people are hurting. Now why, you say, these people are hurting? Some are hurting because of domestic violence. Hey, wrong people of God. Oh, you still live on days. Some are hurting because of various forms of abuse. Some are hurting because of the rising cost of living. Their outgoing. All in their income. Some are hurting because of problems with children. Especially single parents. Those children, as we say, human beings sometimes. Some are hurting because of personal problems with family members. Some are hurting because of how they have to deal with their teenagers. They think they're men and women, so they want to do their own thing. Come on as they like, go on as they please, and give you trouble. Some are hurting because of joblessness, particularly at this time. And there are some with less important concerns, such as tiredness, headache, problem with the roadworks, electricity going off at inconvenient time, water going off just as you're about to go into the shower. All sorts of little things present problems for people. And these people come to church. Amidst all of these challenges, God's word has hope. Yes. It's good news. It says Jesus is the answer. Yes. He says in Matthew 11, 28, 30, turn me to that text, please. Matthew 11. 28 to 30. When you have it, say amen. Or you don't have it yet. Okay, let's read. It says, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you, and learn of me. For I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. That's encouraging, isn't it? We have hope. We have encouragement. We have a place to go. We can go to Jesus because Jesus is the answer. Now, this does not mean that he will automatically eliminate every problem immediately. For as long as we're in this world, we will have problems. You can believe that. But he can resolve our problems if we put our trust in him. Sometimes he does take away our problems miraculously. However, he also grants us power to endure the difficulties and overcome them. He says in 2 Corinthians 12, 9, my grace is sufficient. Remember, Paul had some concern, what he called thorn in the flesh. Just seemed to poke him the wrong way. And he asked the Lord three times, take this from me, let's give him a problem, take it away. And then Jesus says, my grace is sufficient. And he says the same thing to us this morning. His grace is sufficient to help us endure whatever. He has the power to do anything because he's all powerful. Now, the healing of the lame man recorded in our scripture reading, John 5, 1 to 9, is a good example of the awesome power of Jesus. This man was unable to walk for 38 long years. Almost as old as the nation, eh? 38 years, can't walk. He probably was a burden to his family. And by the time he met Jesus, he probably has lost his self-worth because he had to depend on them for everything. And that's something to depend on people for everything. But who created all things had compassion on him and healed him of whatever was ailing him. So he didn't ask for that. But how was this man motivated to receive the healing that Jesus offered? Let me suggest four reasons. Number one, Jesus helped the man identify what he wanted. Look at verse 6 of our scripture. John 5, verse 6. It says, when Jesus saw him lie and knew what he had been, that he had been now a long time in that case, he said unto him, wilt thou be made whole? So Jesus helped him to identify what he wanted. Taking this at face value, that sounds like an absurd question. Of course he wanted to be made whole. He wanted to be healed. That's why he was there every day, wanting to be put into the water. Would you normally ask a starving man if he wanted food? It'd be absurd. But when you examine this situation, it was a valid question. For some people, if given the opportunity of being healed, would actually choose to remain sick.
Right.
You see, being sick frees them from many responsibilities. And they attract sympathy by complaining about their illness. You know, say what every time you say, oh, child this, oh, child that. Always complaining about some illness. The story is told about an American man who didn't want to be drafted in the army. And so he thought of a plan whereby he would disable himself, not be drafted. So he had all of his teeth pulled out. You don't think of anything like that. I said, I'm unfit, so I won't be able to go into service. But then when he went to do the physical, because he had to move through the physical, he thought when he went through the physical, they would see that he didn't have any teeth, so he had a man like that in the army. But when he went to do the physical, discovered that he was declared unfit because he had flat feet. Now he could have saved himself a lot of pain and trouble. Said he'd only gone through the process. He outsmarted himself. So when Jesus asked the man at the pool, do you want to get well? He probably would say, you have friends who bring you here every day, and you form friendship with others who come here regularly too. If I heal you, your life will change radically. You will have to get a job and be responsible for yourself. Are you really ready for this change? Do you really want to get well? This is a question that each of us may need to answer. The first step in going and gaining anything is to want it. The first step in gaining anything is to want it. So we need to decide what we really want. And learn to say with the Apostle Paul, Philippians 4:15, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Secondly, the second requirement for this man's healing was to stop blaming others for his problem. Many of us get to that. We blame the government for it's so easy to blame others, isn't it, for our problems. But that's the way it has been from the beginning of time. Remember our first parents? Then God confronted Adam. Said, this woman you gave me. When he turned around, said, the serpent. Always blaming somebody for something. Mm-hmm. And then remember the story of the Aaron, golden calf. Moses came down and confronted him. Said, the people, always blaming somebody for something. People are the same even today. You've often heard people say, I could stop drinking if my wife would stop nagging me. I would make better grades in school if my teacher doesn't like me. I could do this if such and such is whatever. We tend to blame everybody except ourselves for the difficulty that confronts us. But God wants us to accept responsibility for our behavior. Romans 14:12. What verse did I say? Yeah, let's read that. Romans 14:12 says, so then, every one of us shall do what? Give account of himself to God. Can't blame anybody else. You have to give an account of yourself to God. Somebody say, well, I inherited this temper from my mother, from my father. I can't help myself. Heredity, circumstances, and environment do have a part to influence us. But we can overcome these if we really want to. Remember I said, you have to want to do something in order to achieve it? Some of the most outstanding people in the world had difficult situations to overcome. And some of the most privileged people became complete failures. It is time to stop blaming others and say with the old spiritual, it's me. It's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Not my brother, not my sister, but it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Thirdly, Jesus motivated the lame man to stretch beyond himself. Did what? Wanted to stretch beyond himself. Often Jesus required a dedicated effort on the part of the person being healed. So he asked this man to pick up his bed and walk. He didn't ask him to heal. Go to the pool, whatever. Pick up your bed and walk. Do something. This was a test of the man's resolve and willingness to make the effort to help himself. Jesus asked the man to do something he had not done in 38 years. Now, when Jesus asked him to pick up his bed, all people said, Lord, you're asking the impossible. I've been like this for 38 years. How could I pick up my bed? That's why I'm here. The man didn't do that. At the instruction of Jesus, he had extended his faith and followed Jesus' instruction and received a good result. Yes. When the man made the effort, he was healed. Just as Jesus healed this man and gave him peace of mind, he can do the same for us today. The man was healed instantaneously and completely because he extended his faith. But notice that in order for the man to be healed, he had to get up and stretch. stretch himself beyond what he had been doing usually. If we want to get over the hurts and get well, we must put forth the effort and claim what is available to us. How badly do you want to get rid of the hurt that you're experiencing, of the situation that makes you feel uncomfortable? How badly do you want to get rid of it? You must be willing to reach out in faith and do what Jesus tells you to do. It may even mean swallowing your pride. No, we may even have pride in John, I ain't stupid at that. Not me. We must be able to swallow our pride and admit that we are wrong. 1 John 1 9 says what? If we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So sometimes we have to confess our faults one to another before we can get forgiveness from God. Or you may need to show that you are big enough to forgive those who wronged you. Have you ever heard anybody say, child, I never forgive him for that?
Reach out to Jesus.
abundant